Good afternoon, everyone. We have the pleasure of having Dr. T.S. Nagesh with us. Sir is a professor of Department of Fisheries, Resource Management, Faculty of Fishery Sciences, West Bengal University of Animal and Fishery Sciences, Kolkata. Sir, you are audible as, sir, can you unmute yourself? And you are visible.
Yes, sir.
Can we?
Yes, very good afternoon.
Yeah, you can start, sir.
Yeah. Very good afternoon to all of you. So I thank Dr. Majid for introducing me, Dr. Majid sir. And anyway, it's a very odd time. I know all of you are having a nice lunch and coming here. So definitely I'll try my level best to keep all of you to be in a very good mood so that you will not be sleepy. Okay. So let me start my presentation today. So I have chosen one of the topics, issues in marine fisheries. So when we talk about issues, so where there are no issues, you tell me. So issues are there everywhere, starting from our own individual inside us.
Can we switch to the PPT? PPT is not visible as of now.
Sir, I am. Let me introduce the topic. Okay, sure. Then I'll start
okay,
my
okay.
presentation.
I thought
don't
like
worry.
You were.
No. Don't worry, sir. I'm used to it, because actually from past 1 year we are used to it. So just before starting, just a brief this one, that's it. So where there are no issues, you tell me. So issues start within ourselves, within our individuals level. Then to the highest organization, in every sector, there are issues. So fisheries also no exception, and particularly marine fisheries. And when it comes to matter of the natural resources, so issues are plenty of issues are there. So what I am trying to do is today, so just I am going to present the only the important issues which are we are currently facing in the Indian marine fisheries. So this is my topic, issues in marine fisheries. So before starting, let us reflect why do we bother about issues in marine fisheries? Because I know some of these slides may be very familiar with you for you, just for the sake of keeping my flow topic, my topic in flow. That's why I'm giving some basic aspects. So then I'll move to the issues. So we know the 72% of our surface is covered by water, and the main root for all these issues, whatever we are facing, that is the world's population is increasing at rapid rate, and also it is expected to be reach around 9.7 billion. And 1.66 billion by 2050. And at the same time, we are running shortage of the food production because of the increased demand for the food. And there's a per capita availability of agricultural land is also declining. So there we can play very crucial role, particularly the fisheries. So keeping this in view, FAO's Sustainable Development Goals has started out in 2015, and there are two important goals out of 14 goals I would like to highlight. That is the second one, that is a hunger. We were to fight for the hunger. So that's where this our fisheries can play very, very crucial role. Of course, not only fisheries and agriculture, allied sciences. And the 14th goal, that is sustainable use of ocean. So keeping this in view, I would like to start the topic, keeping these two goals. So this is very familiar, you know, what ocean can provide us. So the 50% or more than 50% of the air we breathe, that comes from the ocean. And it also plays a very important role in climate regulation and transportation, recreation, economy, food, medicine, whatnot, everything. So much of benefits we are getting from the ocean. And of course, fish, we know we are all, most of you, I learned that most of you are already in this fisheries sector. Some of you are assistant professors and are scientists and all the research scholars who are working on the fisheries. So this, I don't have to tell them already. The fish is the very, very important chief source of protein when compared to the land proteins. So fish provides us very good quality protein, vitamins, minerals. So that's why it is very, very important in the food security. So the role of fisheries and aquaculture is nothing new to us. It's a food and nutritional security. Whenever we are talking about food and nutritional security, for the this is one of the important sector that comes to our mind, because globally fish represents about 17% of animal protein and 7% of all protein for human consumption. And 59.5 million people, that is roughly around 12% of the world population, depends on fisheries, directly or indirectly, for their livelihood. And also 16 million people in India, they depend on the fisheries. Of course, the number may be quite high now. And also apart from that, employment generation, Indian economy, it contributes around 1.24% of GVA. And there are plenty of opportunities in fisheries. So because of the vast and varied aquatic resources, whatever we have, the rapid growing population and increased demand for the fish and the food, so available technologies, and particularly India is blessed with a lot of ITKs and for optimum utilization of these resources. And also in the last union budget, so there is a thrust is given on a blue economy, that is a blue revolution. And there is a global demand for fish. And roughly the demand is estimated at 196 million tons by 2025. And India's target for fish production is 22 million tons by 2024-25. And this is already, I already told you. And the present, the Indian fish production potential is estimated at 22.31 million tons. So there is a total potential, including marine and inland. Out of this, the current fish production is around 14.16 million tons. So that means still there is a scope to increase this to the potential of 22.31 in the coming years. And the annual growth rate is around 6 to 10%. And India's position is already known well. So that is the second in total fish production and the fourth in marine fish capture fisheries production. And the per capita fish supply is about 20.5 kg, that is a global. And with this lot of potential and opportunities in the Indian fisheries, so still we are facing a lot of problems in marine fisheries particularly. So this picture depicts why we should worry about these issues, or why we should more concern about these issues. So you can see from 1950 onwards, if you take the marine capture, marine fish production, that is mainly contributed by capture fisheries. So up to 90, after the mechanization of these vessels and boats have occurred in 1950s, 60s and 70s. So later you can see that is the marine fish production has almost become stagnant, oscillating from 2.8 to almost to 3.8, just 1 million metric tons. It has been increased, and this is the trend showing for the past 5 years. You can see we are oscillating from 3.6 to 3.8, with the highest fish production at 3.853 million metric tons in 2018-19. So that was a peak of marine fish production that what we have achieved till now, with the against the fish production potential of 5.31 million metric tons. That is a recent validation by Fishery Survey of India. So, considering this, so there is a considerable gap between potential and the fish production, current fish production. And there is a considerable gap is also between the supply and the demand. So this is where we should take these opportunities and utilize these marine fishery resources to their full potential. And these are the major marine fisheries issues in marine fisheries, particularly the Indian as well as global almost contemplating. So these are the overfishing and overcapacity. Anyway, I'll go one by one. The only, of course, apart from this, you may find a lot of issues. So just I have collected and I am highlighting only those which are very, very important and very concerning at present. So coming to the first one, the overfishing and overcapacity. So actually these words are very, very important to learn. So what is overfishing? What is overcapacity? Because sometimes it looks very similar to us. And particularly those who are not well versed with these terminologies, it looks very similar to us. So capacity in this, and the main reason for overfishing and overcapacity is that ever growing demand and the advancement in technology. So these two have led a very, very serious pressures on the marine fish stocks. And the two important indicators, what you can call it, stock status and the fishing capacity. So these are the two things that you have to monitor always to see whether the fishing is done at whether it is over capacity or whether it is leading to over fishing or not. So capacity means, you know, that is the amount of fish that can be produced over a period of time. And over capacity means it refers to ability of a fleet to fish at levels which exceeded the sustainable catch level. So that is called over capacity, we say. And globally, if you look at the global level of fishing fleets, roughly it is about presently 4.56 million vessels are operating. So there is an estimate that this is two to three times larger than what the oceans can sustainably support. So now you can imagine this is a condition of overcapacity. So already we have led to the overcapacity condition. And if you talk about India also, there are about 2.7 lakhs boats, different vessels are operating all along the Indian coast. But unfortunately, in India also, there are no estimates are available on how many number of crowds would support this sustainable fisheries along the Indian coast. There are no clear-cut estimates are available regarding this. And overfishing refers to the stock which is having a harvest rate higher than the rate that produces its MSY. So overfishing refers to the stock size or the biomass. So that is a biological term. So there are two types of overfishing we know that we are facing: growth overfishing and recruitment overfishing. Growth overfishing occurs when you catch excess juveniles, and the recruitment overfishing occurs when you catch excess brood stock. So both we are facing with both these problems presently. And when the stock is having the population size that is very low, that jeopardizes the stock's ability to produce its maximum sustainable yield, then we call that stock to be overfished. So the stock is said to be overfished when it is not able to produce beyond its MSY level. And what happens to this overcapacity? Well, overcapacity and what are the consequences? So there are plenty of consequences around us. Overcapacity may lead to IUU fishing, that is illegal, unreported and unregulated fishing. There are some biological consequences, that is overfishing. Then economic consequences, that is economical loss may be there, because simply we are wasting our fishing operation without any fish, much fish available in the sea. So that is economic loss. And there is a social consequences, political, regional, national, international consequences. Everything is linked to this overcapacity. And this is the just one estimate, which is the recent estimate from FAO. Here you can see this white line and below, that this area indicates the status of the underfished stock. Underfished means there is a scope to increase the stock. So you can see in the 1974, it was just around around 39%, the underfished stock. 39% were the fish were underfished in 1974. Now it has reduced to just below 10% in 2017. So that means we are catching more and more fish. And this area, the above the white line and this area indicates the maximum biologically sustainable yield. So the biologically sustainable yield also, you can see it is reducing year after year. But the more concern is this orange box, this area, you can see which was around 65.8%. Now it is roughly around 90%. It was there. Then roughly it has been reduced to 65.8%. The percentage of overfish stock, on the other hand, has increased from 9% to 34%. 9% to 34%, it is increased overfished stocks. So this is where we are concerned about this. And overall, if you look at, there are about 523 selected world fish stocks have been assessed so far, and about 80 to 90% are already overexploited. And there are, in some cases, already rebuilding of stocks have been taken place, that is as a part of conservatory measures, and with some good results also, quite successful results, particularly in the temperate water fishes. coming to Indian scenario also, in 2011, so there was one workshop work group has been made to assess the fish stock, what is the status of the fish stock. And recent studies indicated that most of the fish stocks are being exploited very close to the maximum sustainable yield, and even some of them are over-exploited, and very few of them are under-exploited. So this is definitely a recent assessment puts an average over-capacity to the tune of 56%. Already we are over-capacity which is existing in India. And in addition to that, there is inappropriate exploitation pattern is another serious problem. So that means very 0 to 50 meter depth near shore waters, which is already fully utilized or even over exploited. Whereas if you go to the deep sea and oceanic resources and even some non-conventional resources like myctophytes, jellyfish and deep sea oceanic squids. So these are the stocks which are underutilized till now, where we can give more fishing pressure so that we can increase the fish production from the current level. So these are some of the list of the stocks which are available, which are over-exploited species-wise and stock-wise along the Indian coast. And this is one example. This is a recent story. I think you must be knowing this one. So decline in the Indian oil sardine fishery along the Kerala coast during 2030. This is a classical example of how overfishing can collapse a very, very important Indian oil sardine fishery along the Kerala coast. You know, Indian oil sardine fishery along with Indian mackerel fishery, so they form a very significant contribution along the southwest coast. During 2012, the sardine catch was 3.9 lakh tons, so which was the highest during the last two centuries, if you see. Whereas, suddenly it declined by 46% in 2013 and then to a 61% in 2014, and 82% decline has been noticed in 2015. So that is reaching only 68,000. In 2015, the Indian oil sardine catch was the very, very minimum, which was reduced to only 68,431 tons. So later on, ICR CMFRA, the Pioneer Institute, it has conducted a very detailed investigation over this. What happened to this? Why it happened like this? So because large number of fishermen who are depending on this fishery, so they submitted a report which clearly said that it is a cumulative effect of overfishing of this fishery above MSY in 2011 and 2012. Along with that, there are some other factors also. There was poor recruitment, environmental stress due to salinity stratification. That may be related to your climate change and the low food availability and comparatively very higher temperature. So this salinity and temperature, these are related to the climate change. So overfishing also has contributed to the decline in the sardine fishery. So now second issue. So second issue, climate change. So this is the one where we are, everything we are linking to the climate change nowadays. Whatever the problems we are facing, we are linking directly or indirectly to the climate change. So climate change, what it is and how it can affect our fisheries. So climate change affects agriculture and even fisheries by increased frequency of dry spells, that is rising in temperature, changes in precipitation patterns, very unusual precipitation pattern, not a regular precipitation, rainfall will be there, very unusual time or unusual, sometimes very high precipitation or very low precipitation, and increasing intensity of extreme weather events. So these are some of the, and ocean acidification. So these are some of the effects of this climate change. So I'm not going to all this greenhouse effect. These are all very basic, and we know how we are getting the climate is changing because of the global warming. That is mainly because of these greenhouse gases, carbon dioxide, water vapor, methane, and nitrous oxide. These are considered to be the greenhouse effect. And this is the very greenhouse effect phenomena that is very familiar to you. I'm not telling all those things. So this is how the greenhouse gases has been increasing over the years from last 40 years. So you can see slowly how they are increasing in the atmosphere and causing the global warming. And how it affects on the fisheries. So rising of sea surface temperature. So that is one of the there are plenty of studies are being carried out, and it has been studied. It has been noted that the sea surface temperature has increased by 0.2 degree centigrade along the northwest, southwest, and northeast coast, and 0.3 degree centigrade along the southeast coast during the 45-year period from 1960 to 2005. Of course, it is just a bit old data, but even there is a clear-cut indication that the sea surface temperature is increasing, and this increase is predicted to be the temperature is predicted to increase by 2 degree centigrade to 3.5 degree, 2 to 3.5 degree increase may be there by another 70-80 years by 2099. And this sea surface, because as we know, every physiology, basic physiology of the fish, it depends on the temperature. Temperature is the most regulating factor. Not only it affects the distribution pattern and the physiology of the fish. So the main factor here, how the temperature rise influences the fisheries, it may change the distribution pattern of the fish. And the second one is sea level rise. So we know sea level rise also has been noticed, and along the southwest coast itself. So there is an estimated that about 2 centimeter there was a rise, and it may rise at the rate of 5 millimeter per year in decades to come. So this is the rate at which it is going to increase in the years to come. So this is very, very serious phenomena. Sea level rise, because we know it may affect the increased erosion or increased risk of flooding, or they inhibit the primary productivity level may come down. So there may be changes in the surface water quality, groundwater characteristics, plenty of other series of factors associated with sea level rise. And apart from this direct effect, direct or indirect effect of fisheries, so this sea level rise also affects the displacement of the people. So there is an estimate from the Ministry of Environment and Forest that a 1 meter sea level rise is projected to displace approximately 7.1 million people in India. So that is where it is another issue of sea level rise. And how it is going, how this climate change on these factors, how it is going to influence on marine fisheries. So they may bring about the stress in fish stock because of the change in the physiology. There may be changing in the reproductive physiology. As already been the studies which have been conducted by ICR CIFRI, which clearly said that the IMC have already extended the breeding period because of this temperature change. And some fishes have been noticed faster growth rate, early maturity, early also extended breeding period. You may think that it is a good for fishery. So because if the breeding period extended, we can produce more seeds and we can get more fish. But it is also associated with less fecundity also, and maybe survival rate also. That has to be studied and validated further. And there may be changes in the distribution and migration pattern. So that I am going to tell how Indian mackerel and how Indian oil sardine have changed their distribution pattern because of this climate change. So this is about the Indian oil sardine and the Indian mackerel, how they are affected by this climate change. So these two species have been studied by ICRCMFRI. They are known to extend their distributional range. They have extended their distributional range. And besides exploring the northern waters, the Indian mackerel has been descending deeper. It is moving to the deeper waters as well during the last 2 decades. And other studies which have been conducted by CIFRI and other institutes, they have studied that reduction in the mean size of the fishery of Indian oil sardine, pink perch, reduction in the length at first maturity, that is early maturity, reduction in fecundity, that's not a good sign, change in the spawning season, and change in the diet composition. So all these are the effects of climate change. Of course, the studies are in still infant stage. More studies are needed to confirm this is mainly due to climate change. And this is coral bleaching. So coral bleaching, so it is very well known phenomena. This is also due to warmer water temperatures. that is rise in the water temperature that resulting in expulsion of symbiotic zooxanthellae from the tissues of coral. So you can see here, this is a healthy coral and how it is changing, and this is a bleached coral because of the expulsion of the symbiotic zooxanthellae. And without zooxanthellae, we know they exhibit symbiotic relationship, so the corals cannot survive. And ocean acidification. So this is another factor related to climate change. So this is seawater by absorbing carbon dioxide and forming carbonic acid is yet another significant challenge to the survival of the marine fish. So this is this picture also, you can see that how in the late 1800, so the average seawater pH, it was more than 8. So now in 2100, it is estimated that it is it may reduce to below 8, or now already it is coming down. The pH level is coming down, so that is the resultant of ocean acidification. Next, coming to bycatch and discards. So bycatch and discards, so this is another very important issue in marine fisheries. So actually, these words already, again, it is familiar to you, bycatch and discards. So whenever the marine fish catch is taken, it can be divided into two types, retained catch and the discards. Discards are the portion of the catch that is thrown back to the sea because of various reasons, again, because of various reasons, because of their non-commercial importance, because of their size, and because some of them which are not supposed to be caught, but they have been taken illegally, so that also be thrown out into the sea. And retained catch, again, there is a target catch and the retained bycatch. So this retained bycatch is not much to worry until and unless if you are discarding the juveniles, if you are catching more and more juveniles, so then no need to worry about bycatch much, because most of the bycatch is also marketed, and after coming to the landing center, so it is also being marketed. So only the bycatch issue will come when there is a plenty of juveniles are there in the fish catch or in the bycatch. So then only we should be more concerned about the bycatch. Otherwise, if you can manage bycatch effectively, then there is no need of worry about the bycatch. Only we should worry more about the discards. So this particularly, we know the diversification of the Indian marine fisheries has resulted in expansion of all these mechanized trawlers. And this trawling is one of the most controversial method of fishing till now because of its non-selective fishing gear, but particularly the bottom trawl. And particularly in if you look at our situations in India, where we are facing multi-species and multi-gear nature. So this is the most complicated issue by catch, because we are targeting one fish, at the same time you are invariably other fishes are also being caught. And all these discards, so they may lead to depletion of the resources and having negative impacts on the biodiversity. So this bycatch, if you don't manage it properly, at least there are three areas where we should look into more. That is biological, ecological, and economical also. So all these three issues are bothering us. And if you look at the bycatch composition in the Indian waters, there are a number of species are being reported in the bycatch, which vary from 87 to 281 species in the bycatch itself. And the percentage of bycatch, it is roughly, it is up to 65% to 95% has been reported. So don't worry about this figure, 65% to 95% bycatch. You should not, there is no exclamation, there is no need to too much worry about this, because most of them are already marketed also. What is most worried is this percentage of discards. See, the percentage of discards, the range is from 4% to 62%, and on an average 15% to 20% of the catch is being thrown back into the sea. That is a waste. That is a biological waste, economical waste, and ecological also issues may arise because of that, because of the depletion of the resources. And there is an estimate from the global annual discard marine capture fisheries between 2010 to 2014, it was around 9.1 million tons of fishes have been thrown back to the sea. That is a waste. So as I said, the bycatch, we should, the impact is more when the bycatch includes capture of threatened fishes or vulnerable fishes or endangered fishes like turtles and all, that is a very well known, and depleted fishery resources, lower catch of target species, and higher fuel cost and less profit. So all these are the impacts of this bycatch. And this bycatch generally consists of, as I told you, the species from 87 to 281, but the major groups are fishes, cnidarians, that is cylindrates, mollusks, crustaceans, echinoderms, like starfishes, sea urchins, and other things, then juveniles of fish. So this is where we are losing much in the bycatch. So I'm not going to tell about this BRDs, just for your reference. That is the how to avoid this bycatch is one of the means of getting reduction in the bycatch is use of BRDs, bycatch reduction devices. So there are many bycatch reduction devices along the Indian coast is also being developed by particularly ICR or CAFT. So these are the bycatch reduction devices, like for example, fish eye in the trawl net, then the wider panel, then turtle excluder devices. So all these, they are very popular. Nowadays, we are more concerned about this use of this bycatch reduction devices. And also there is a wide use of this square mesh cord end. So that is also being used as one of the measures to reduce this bycatch, particularly the juveniles. Next issue is eco labels. So this is the latest issue which are coming, which is recently everyone is concerned about this. Particularly once we are looking for international trade, so one definitely we should think more about eco labels. So what are eco labels? Eco labels are seals of approval given to the products that are deemed to have fewer impacts on the environment than functionally or competitively similar products. That is, most importantly in eco labels, what we are doing, traceability of the seafood. So starting from the harvesting till it reaches to the consumer, we can trace it, where it is, how it is, how it is being caught, how it is being marketed, whether it was environmentally friendly or whether all the sustainable rules have been maintained as per the national or the international laws. So this is the traceability. So this is very, very important nowadays. And that is the main goal to promote sustainable fisheries management, to tap the growing public demand for environmentally preferable products. So this is concern is getting more and more among the public, and to determine the environmental impact from cradle to grave. So that is a traceability. So eco labeling programs can be done at three levels. That is, first one, at first party labeling schemes, that is a self declaration. Suppose you are starting one fishery or culture or whatever it may be, you self declare, yes, these are the standard protocols have been followed, and these are the cares have been taken. So, and you declare yourself. So that is a first party labeling. Second party labeling means these are established by industry associations. So some group of industry associations, they will make their own assessment and they will give the certificate. Yes, these are the, they are eco-friendly product, which can be used. But compared to this first party and second party labeling scheme, the most widely accepted one is third party labeling scheme, where you do not have any role. The third party will come and they will assess all your procedures, protocols, which are being followed in your fishery, and that will be certified by the third party. And this is having the more valued. So this is one of the Marine Stewardship Council, MSC. So it is an independent, not-for-profit, non-profit, international body headquartered in London. So this is one such council, it is involved in issuing these eco labels. So this is the logo, as you can see here. So this is the logo that they give to the fishery or the product which satisfy all the principles of sustainability. So there are many fisheries are also already got the MSC certificates, and these are the three core principles of MSC fishery standard. So if one has to get the MSC certificate, they have to follow these three principles: sustainable fish stock, minimizing environmental impact, and effective fisheries management. So you can see some of the products here with MSC logo on their products. And in Indian marine fisheries, the community based Ashtamudi lake, that is in Kerala, they have the very popular fishery there, that is for the short neck clam fishery, that is Paphia malabarica fishery. So this is the first fishery which got the MSC certified fishery in India. And presently, our ICR CMFRI, along with some other agencies, they are working on these fisheries to get these MSC certificates. That is blue swimming crab, shrimp by trawl by column, red ring shrimp, squid, flower shrimp trawl, cuttlefish, lobster by trap fishery in Nagarkoil in Kanyakumari, skipjack tuna. So these fisheries now are being monitored very closely so that they are in line, pipeline, to get this MSC eco labeling from Indian waters. Next comes habitat destruction. So this is the most dangerous issue, which is mainly by the anthropogenic activities. This is the man-created activities. There are plenty of issues. I am not going to tell all those things. There may be plastics. There is a growing concern. So this is microplastic particles, especially in the sea, ghost fishing, ecologically sensitive areas getting disturbed every year, unmanaged expansion of aquaculture, then oil spills, fly ash deposition, and untreated public sewage. All these, there are plenty of factors which are collectively or cumulatively destroying the habitats. So once the habitat is destructed, so that means that is the end of it. So that means we have lost everything. There are no further resources will be available. So that is why, though it is a slow process, but it is very, very dangerous, because ultimately it leads to changes in genetic composition of marine organisms, which are the matter of concern for long-term changes in the coastal fauna. So that is why habitat destruction to be taken very, very seriously. And this is some of the examples of recent outputs of, in 2017, there was an oil spill in the Tamil Nadu, that is Ennore area, and there was estimated that 65 tons of slick was removed from the oil spillage, that is due to collision of two ships, and there was a leak in the tanker. So you can see the slicks here, and this is the untreated, this is very common, we are not able to control this untreated public sewage, and fly ash from the thermal power plant. And about this plastics, I don't have to say this, because each and every one of us, we are responsible, including me, including you. So every one of us is responsible for this situation, you can see here. So it is a very, very, very pathetic, very, very pathetic and very disturbing situation to see this whale with plenty of plastic. I think most of you have seen this picture. It has come in the social media, it has come in the Facebook, WhatsApp, and all the newspapers. So this is what we are, this is one photo, but can you imagine all over the world how many such cases may be there? So plenty of cases. You can see here in this picture what I have shown you, the necropsy of this animal revealed 40 kilogram, 40 kg of plastics inside the whale's stomach. So that is a condition we are making these animals not to live more. Next issue is IUU fishing. IUU fishing is refers to illegal, unreported and unregulated fishing. So it is believed that it occurs in most of the fisheries in the range of 15 to 30% of the catch is directly related to IUU, either illegal or unreported or unregulated fishing. It leads to many things, mainly the local, the loss of biodiversity, which damages the ecosystem and food security, and loss to the economy and the government revenue. Because if it is not reported, it is a loss to the government revenue. And these losses estimated at $23 billion per year. It is a loss to the industry as a whole. And among the fishing nations, 90% of the members across the world have identified this is as a major problem in their regions. Of course, India is very committed to combat this fishing, IUU fishing. So I don't have to tell the definition of IUU fishing. It is there in the name itself, illegal, when any contravention in the national, regional or international laws is done in the fishing. So that is referred to as illegal. If the any catch, either in the small quantity or in the large quantity, if it is not reported or it is misreported, catching more fish and giving the less information, so that is unreported and unregulated. Again, it is because of the lack of the policies. There is no regulation in the fishing. So that is IUU fishing. So these are the causes of IUU fishing. As I told you in the beginning itself, overcapacity is one of the causes that leads to IUU fishing. Then weak governance. So this is a very, very important. If the governance is not strong, if it is not committed, so definitely this leads to IUU fishing. Then ill implementation of the existing legislations, then lack of will and awareness among the people, among the stakeholders, everyone, stakeholders means not the only fishermen, not only the administration, bureaucrats, scientists, every level. So there is a lack of will, and of course awareness is there, but will is not there in some cases. Then inadequate for trained personnel, and last but not the least, ethics. So this is very, very important, ethics of the stakeholders. And India is also trying its level best to combat this IUU fishing with the linkages of the BOBP, which is mainly looking after the artisanal fisheries, sustainable artisanal fisheries, the IOTC, Indian Ocean Tuna Commission, which is looking after the how to regulate this tuna and elite fishes in the Indian Ocean. Then India is also a member of Asia Pacific Fishery Commission, which is mainly looking after to promote the full and sustainable utilization of living aquatic resources. India is also a member of International Whaling Commission, that is for effective conservation and management of whale stocks. So how to combat this IUU fishing? As I told you already, that is setting up of strong MCS, monitoring, control and surveillance system, vessel monitoring system, documentation of vessels and catch, blockchain technology. This is a recent one. Blockchain technology, I think most of you are familiar now. This is a digital framework where everything is recorded digitally and it can be traced, any mismanagement, any reporting is there. So there is a least chance of misreporting. So this is very easy to say, this setting up of strong MCS, VMS, but difficult for the developing countries because of huge infrastructure, huge cost investment is required to fully implement this VMS or MCS system. And next issue, I hope, can I take another 5 minutes?
Yeah, please do.
Yeah, fine, thank you. So this is another issue which is very much concerned for the fishermen particularly, that is safety. Safety at sea is a very, very serious issue because every life is important. Every fisherman's life is very, very important to save because they are the ones who are feeding the world. So every life is important here. So fishing is probably one of the most dangerous occupation in the world because once you are at the sea, So, and if you are, if any conditions, any unfavorable conditions will come in the sea, it is not very easy to come back to the land again very soon. So, because of various that you know that is, and it is estimated by the Indian Labour Organization, so that globally about 24,000 fishermen succumb to death annually. So this is very, very serious concern, you know. So this is because, and this is 24,000 fishermen succumb to death. This is only reported and recorded. And forget about, can you imagine how many are not reported, not recorded? Plenty, maybe more than this. So maybe more than this. And this fatality occurs due to various factors, lack of life-saving appliances, lack of distress alarming systems, poor communication systems, lack of skilled manpower, unfavorable weather conditions, many things. And these are some of the institutes which are closely monitoring and regulating this safety at sea. That is International Maritime Organization, International Labour Organization, FAO. So these are the specialized agencies which are looking after the welfare of the fishermen at the sea, safety of the fishermen at the sea. And the next issue is conflicts in the marine fisheries sector. And these conflicts are very common because, you know, if you look at our deep sea fishing policy, when it was introduced first in 1991, so for that time also, there was a lot of conflicts between the traditional fishermen or the local fishermen and the government, because the government was trying to introduce the foreign vessels under the foreign chartered policy. So there many issues have come out. The fishermen went on strike. There was a lot of conflicts. So ultimately, there was some changes have been suggested by the committee. So all this. And there is another conflicts. Conflicts may occur. It may be various natures, like international. It may be of international, between the nations. It may be technological conflicts between the, say, for example, artisanal fisheries and mechanized fisheries. Particularly when both of them are operating in the same fishing area. Of course, considering this, every state now under the Marine Fisheries Regulation Act, so every state have already demarcated what should be the area, minimum, say, up to 6 nautical miles or up to 8 nautical miles or something like that. It is exclusively for the artisanal fisheries, small-scale fisheries, traditional boats, and beyond that, it is meant for mechanized boats. So every state has already demarcated it under the Marine Fisheries Regulation Act of 1984. But even then, sometimes this mechanized fishing vessel trying to enter into these artisanal fisheries, they are trying to catch it. So that there arises the conflict. Then there is a conflict between the between the states within a country. So this is also very very frequent among the states. Between the fishermen of the two states, very closely related states. And there is an inter-industry between the fishing industry and other industries. Conflicts may arise. So these are some of the conflicts. And lastly, this is the last issue, that is a poor implementation of regulations. So I am telling you the last issue because so you'll be pleased to see that last slide also. So you'll be happy to see that last slide. So yes, sir has told poor, the last word. So, poor implementation of regulations. So, having said, India or for that matter, global, there are plenty of regulations, rules, policies, acts, everything is available. Everything is available. But the implementation is very, very poor. And for that, we cannot blame. As you see, now COVID we are facing, every guidelines is available, still we are not following it. So that is the reason why we are sitting here and doing this online seminars. And like that, fisheries is also not exception. As we know, as early as 1897, Indian Fisheries Act came, and till now, 2020, National Policy on Marine Fisheries has come. In between this, there are plenty of policies, national, state level, national level, international level, so many regulations, so many policies have come. But even then, we are not able to control, or we are not able to save our diversity, and we are facing these issues continuously. This is the biggest challenge because of this diverse socio-economic conditions in the developing countries like India and different political and cultural environments. So that is giving a lot of problems in the implementation. And in India, there is no stock monitoring programs. Unlike in some of the countries, they have stock monitoring programs regular. But in India, we do not have such stock monitoring programs. So that is where we are not able to implement its full status. So this is the strategies for addressing these issues. Of course, I am not telling all these strategies because are very well known. Whatever the issues are there closely, we should not do or we should do. So like that. So that is about the strategies. So this in 2015, FAO has developed 17 sustainable development goals with 169 targets and 230 indicators of the 2030 agenda for sustainable development. So by 2030, so starting from 2015, to 2030, they have listed out different sustainable development goals. Among them, the 14th goal is life below water, that is conserve and sustainably use the oceans, sea and marine resources for sustainable development. So the target was by 2015 to by 2020, countries commit. So every country should make their commitment to achieve sustainable management of marine ecosystems by protecting ecosystems, rebuilding stocks, then controlling IUU fishing, destructive fishing practices. See, this destructive fishing practices, I should not tell about this because it's a very tragedy. Because 1897, the first Indian Fisheries Act, it is mentioned how serious it is. It should be banned, destructive fishing practice like cyaniding or using these explosives in the fisheries. But even now, sometimes we are reading in the newspapers and we are getting this news, this practice is even now it is existing. And by 2025, the target is to significantly reduce marine pollution of all kinds and so that it to minimize the impact of ocean acidification. And by 2030, to increase the income benefits from the oceans, to increase the income benefits from the ocean by 2030. So this is about this one. And so these are the strategies which is mentioned in the National Policy on Fisheries to address these issues. National Policy on Fisheries, which has implemented from 2020, which is specifically tells about these issues, how to address it, evaluation of fishing effort management, conservation of ecologically, that is sensitive areas, and efficient use of information technology, then strengthening of MCS and VMS systems, then improved fisheries governance, then it talks about ecosystem approach, that is co-management, where all the stakeholders will be taken into confidence for the fisheries sustainable management, then integration of CCRF, then encouragement of PPP, then enhancing skills and capabilities, then integration of fishery products with the food safety standards, benchmarks, and of course, fishermen's welfare. So these are some of the strategies we have to look into this. So this is about my presentation. So to conclude, I should say a focused action plan should be required, keeping three things in our view, that is biological, environmental, and socio-economical sustainability and biosecurity in view so that we can achieve ICAR's visions, Fish for All Forever, or FAO's Sustainable Development Goals, as I mentioned earlier, so that and in realizing the country's dream for achieving real blue revolution. So thank you very much. So this is about my presentation. So if you want to, you can have some kind of interaction.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Now, if there are any questions or interactions, please ask.
I hope I have not taken much time.
No, just we have few minutes for the interaction. We have about 3 minutes.
Okay, okay. No, I hope I have not taken much time. No, is it okay, time man?
Yes, it was perfect.
I am sharing the slides to you, Dr. Mahi sir.
Please reply to the email. Same email. You can directly reply to that email.
Okay. I am sharing the slides also, and my manuscript I have already sent to the mail. I think you must have received it. And presentation also I am sharing it. If any participant wants it, so you may share among them.
No problem. I'll make it part of the YouTube video. It will be part of the description itself.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I don't think there are any questions, sir. On behalf of the participants and on behalf of all the organizing committee, we extend our gratitude to you, sir. Thank you for being with us here today and sharing such a lovely perspective on things, and especially the presentation was nice. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Majid, and also I thank for giving me this opportunity, not only for me, to our institute, Faculty of Fisheries Science and our university, so that we are able to conduct 21 days program. Definitely without your help and without your initiation, it could not have been done. So this was our beyond imagination that we could do this 21 days program with your help. So on behalf of my faculty and institute, I also thank you very much for this opportunity. And I thank all the participants for their patient hearing. Without sleeping, I think, because I'm not able to see any one of you here. But anyway, so thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. So feel free to ask or interact with me, not only now, if you want to know also. Otherwise, my email contact is there with you, most of you. So you are most welcome to have any kind of interaction, even after this presentation also. Thank you so much again.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. I think tomorrow is going to be assignment. That assignment will be shared on the group, and you guys would get the assignment on the group itself, and you would have to submit by the end of the day, I guess. Thank you. Details will be shared on your WhatsApp group. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah.